the camera needs to be around about eye level. So if the camera's way up high, it doesn't look good, and if the camera's way down low, it doesn't look good. It creates all kinds of other associations. Like when the camera's high, it can look patronising. And when the camera's low, it's sort of like I can have... it looks like I'm trying to be an action superhero, because that's often used in Hollywood for making somebody seem more important. When the camera's roughly eye level, it's straight to. You know, it's I'm talking directly to you. And if I'm talking, if the camera's up there and I'm talking up like that, well, I'm talking up to you, and I'm talking down to you if you're down there, whereas I want to be on your level. And having the camera on your level, on my level, means that we are on the same level, and that means we can communicate better. The filmmaker's maxim is the rule of thirds. In other words, you can divide the screen into thirds, this way and that way, and the main subjects of interest are on those intersections of thirds lines. So my head should be roughly on one of those thirds lines, which means that this area here is free to for me to put bullet points over, which is really, really handy, because often if you accent the important things you want to say with a bullet point on screen, it can really ram home that point. I mentioned this before when I was talking about the rule of thirds, but leaving room to put bullet points on the screen can really help to emphasise the key points. So frame up in such a way that you've got the room to do that. As much as possible, make sure you've got more stuff in your video presentation than just someone talking. So I've recorded a whole lot of me talking. This is going to be the shots you're looking at now are going to be the main spine of the presentation that you're going to be seeing. But I'm going to make sure that I've got as much other stuff to show you as possible, so that there's action, there's pictures, because we like pictures. That's the reason we have that video is so attractive, is that people like moving pictures and they like people telling them stories. So through stories and through having the moving images, we've got an inherently powerful medium, but let's not abuse it by just having that. The more stuff you can put in, the more graphic information you've got, the more that people will pick up, and the better things will stick. And it will simply not, if I just talk to you, it'll be boring. Keep things short. Keep things short, focused, and concise. Make them dense. Make them so dense that people might want to go back and watch the episode again. You don't need to repeat information overly, but it can be good to reinforce a few key points at the end of each section. But overall, in terms of your duration, I think, you know, 2 minutes is really good. 10 minutes, if you've got a meaty subject, that's worthwhile. That's okay. Beyond 10 minutes, you're really stretching things out. If you've got the resources that a TED Talk has, and here we're talking about 30 or 40 people on the crew, a stage, an audience, multiple cameras, professional lighting, people working dedicated sound, radio mics, all the graphic stuff that you could ever wish for, well, you can pull that out to 18 minutes. But even a TED Talk that runs for 30 minutes is gonna get tedious. You don't have the resources that TED Talks have. So keep it short, keep it focused. If you've got more to say than you can fit into 10 minutes, break it into 2 5-minute sections, or, you know, break it into smaller chunks. So as you see what I've done here, and I've made a YouTube playlist which connects all the bits together, and it means that when you come to watch this, I don't expect that you're going to watch all of the entire, you're not going to sit in front of your computer and watch the whole lot. You'll watch a couple, and then you'll come back tomorrow and watch a couple more. And you'll pick out the ones that are particularly relevant to you, because they're organized as well as I can, so that you can find the bits that are relevant to you. That's the process you want. You want to have it, you want to break things into small chunks and make it easy for people to find them. So like I've got just some plywood behind me, which is not too intrusive. It means you're looking at me, not at the background. If I had a whole lot of books behind me, they might distract a little bit, and they would certainly distract if they were big enough for you to read the titles, because instead of looking at me, you might start reading the titles. So you want something which is going to focus your attention on the person speaking. Expect that your first take is going to be lousy. It's going to take you several runs at it to get things to work well. If you're a top-notch professional actor and you've got a good cameraman, well, you might get it in one take. But I don't think that that's going to be the case. I think that what you need to bear in mind is your first take's going to be lousy and stilted. You'll look at it back and you'll see, oh, gee, I could do this better, I could do that better. And then you'll grow your performance. You'll be more animated, more involved. Plus also, the first take might just have a simple technical problem. Build your performance out of several takes where possible. You'll notice that there are those nice little black cards that I've got interspersed which tell you the topic of the next bit coming up. Well, those are actually bits that I've cut out where I was looking at the script. Or those are bits where I've started and I've wandered off topic, or I've just mangled my words and I've just done it all wrong. By having those cards to block out things, it gives us a nice subject header, but it also means that I get the better performances. I don't have the lousy, stilted ones. I'm not going to show you those because they're awful. And everybody produces lousy, stilted performances sometimes. The more you do it, the more you get used to talking to the camera. The more you do it, the more you warm up, and you get better and better and better as you go on. So expect you'll have to do this several times over. It's not going to come out right the first time. One other point with tie clip microphones is to avoid the rustling sound you'll get if you touch them. You need to keep your hands away from them. And for that matter, this wonderful, fantastic $12 Devalier mic is not particularly durable. It won't stand any abuse. Don't zoom. One of the hallmarks of amateur video making is using the zoom rocker. So here's a... if you've got a little camera like this, using this zoom rocker here or wherever it is on your camera while you're shooting looks amateurish. It's distracting. Frame up your shot using the zoom control if you need to. Then shoot, but keep your finger off the zoom control while shooting. When you've finished, stop, and then you can reframe using the zoom control if you have to. It's almost as if, for some people, it's like they've got a control and they have to use it. So try to keep your fingers off that. If you're shooting a video of somebody else, basically you want nothing to happen during the process of shooting the video. You are just going to stand there and become a tripod or to follow the action. But there isn't much, you want to stay away from the controls while shooting. Next one, focus. In this case, when I set this shot up, the focus was on the wall behind me because I wasn't here and the camera didn't have anything to focus on. And when I got here, the camera didn't readjust to focusing on me. So the first take of this shot had me had the wall in focus. The wall was in sharp focus and I was just a little bit soft. So to fix that, I got a cereal packet and put it where I am. Of course, any object would do. It just happened I happen to have a cereal packet handy because I'm making these at home. So I put a cereal packet here on the edge of the table, focused on that, and then that's left me in focus and the wall being just slightly soft. So having a stand-in, either a second person to come and sit where you're going to be or an object, whatever's handy, to focus on can be really useful.